please, you have to be patient. And I strongly believe the only reason for which you are here is to grace the occasion, and the formalities surrounding the occasion should be demonstrated. So please, please, be tolerant as we usher in our guest lecturer. So can we please stand as we welcome on stage Dr. H. Bama Famule. Amanda! Amanda! Say you!
The guest president, say
you!
Thank you, comrade, thank you. Is this all right?
The mic, it's on, put it on.
It's on.
Put it on, put it on.
Take care of
it.
Thank you, comrade, thank you, thank you. Thank you, sir.
My friend said, I'm so worried.
Yes, sir!
My dear comrades and friends, militants in the people's struggle, it is an honor for me to be among you. As you know where we have stood for the past 3 decades in the history of our country, we fight under the banner of justice and liberty. We fight under the banner of the people's determination to change the history. Under the shade we have lived, under the shade we will die. We make no fuss with those who have their own history to tell. We accept the fact that people in this country over the past 30 years have been telling the history. But it's not the history as we know it. Quite recently, comrades, we heard a good bishop saying to the people of Liberia that the regime of Mr. Talbot was a good regime, granted, that the regime of Mr. Talbot was acceptable and would have done great things had it not been for the fact that some greedy young men, greedy, he said, came and disrupted the process. Before I begin, I want to say something to this bishop. You see, Mr. Bishop, there is only one thing that determines one's integrity, is that to always be honest with the truth.
Sound.
You must understand what is happening in this society, and you must say to the young people that there was an intensive struggle which called on the most courageous of all those who participated to struggle against tyranny, that which suppressed the people, that which denied the people the right to select their representatives. Our duty, comrades, was to make sure that at the end of the struggle, we hold in one hand the tribune of freedom, and at our feet would be the dead body of tyranny. Mr. Bishop, I would have understood you very well had you said to the Liberian people that these young men had come with so much idealism, that these young men had returned home with fire in the guts and ideas in the head. You could have said to the Liberian people that probably they were intoxicated with the exuberance of youth, the happiness of young people. That would have been understood. But Mr. Bishop, to say that young men who came back home with terminal degrees, beautiful children and beautiful wives, were reckless enough to put their bodies on the line simply because they were greedy, you have done a great disservice to the people. And let me say to you, Mr. Bishop. You talk about people being greedy. I say to you, Mr. Bishop, you preside over a church where you go against the dictates of the Bible. The Bible says, the sweat of the brow shall they eat. Mr. Bishop, you live on rent. You live on rent. You have not said to us that this massive property your church owns in Mamba Point and around Monrovia, you said they were given to you by J.J. Roberts. Mr. Bishop, the time will come when you have to show the people the will of J.J. Roberts. You have to tell us who is greedier. Those who think that they have a right to struggle for justice, and you who sit, live on the taxes and the taxes of your people, and want to say to the Liberian people that your society would have been better had these people not come. Mr. Bishop, history does not operate in that way. History does not operate in if, then. If this had not happened, that would have happened. If my mother had not met my father, I would not have been born. If your mother had not met your father, you would not have been born. History does not run on suppositions. History runs on facts. There was disagreement. There were grievances in the country. People were annoyed at the fact that after 127 years, you refused to live up to the creed of your own constitution, which says that all men are created equal, endowed by the creators with certain inalienable rights, among those like liberty and the pursuit of happiness. We decided, Mr. Bishop, to hold you to the creed that you have preached so long, that all your brothers were with you, one people, that you have come from afar and you have met them here. They had pleaded with you, come let us sit together under the same tree. And like African people, let us be leaves of the same branch and branches of the same tree. You have still not understood what happened in this country. Mr. Bishop, you have come to tell our people that people were executed. We the first to say to you, every family has a right to grieve for their relatives. But Mr. Bishop, there's nowhere in your Bible where it says you must be selective in the choices you make for historical victims. People, children die. And when you want to engage us or tell our people, you must explain what happened in the society. We were not crazy young people. And as a result, if we are not careful, what we try to sweep under the rug will come back tomorrow to haunt our children. And this is what we do not want to do. I say to you, comrades, in the history of humanity, sometimes the shortfalls, the pitfalls in the struggle for liberty and equality can be short-lived. Men put their lives on the line and they struggle. Sometimes there are setbacks. Sometimes there are failures. But I say to you, you must never ever give up. We have to uphold liberty. We have to hold justice. As long as there is liberty, even if we don't reach where we want to go, we can start over again. And what did we do? As a matter of fact, in 1979, and I want to fast track, because I know why you called me here, you have a lot of questions to ask. I'm just going to give you a summary. In 1979 in this country, there were two groups calling for changes. One was the Progressive Alliance of Liberia, led by the late Venerable Comrade Marcus Matthews. The other was the Movement for Justice in Africa. I've read things in the papers. These were two different groups, totally different. Different in their ideology, different in their understanding, different in their approaches. They were no different from all the various political groups in African countries. In Angola, you had three groups fighting for independence in Angola. You had the MPLA, you had UNITA, you had FNLA. They were all fighting for independence, but they had different ideas of how to accomplish the emancipation of the people. The same with Mozambique, all African countries. When the departing colonialists were leaving, they handpicked people and they gave them power. There were others who struggled against it. So in Liberia by 1979, two groups had emerged. One of such groups, the Progressive Alliance of Liberia, headed by Bartholomew Matthews, has started in the United States of America. The other group, the Movement for Justice in Africa, had decided that looking at the terrain in Africa, it was better to adopt an approach to educate the Liberian people as to why black men and women were bold enough to take up arms in those African countries. They said we will not concentrate on Liberia. Very simple, comrades. In politics, you must understand tactics and strategy. If you do not, you will blunder because the people look up to you to give them direction. If you don't understand how to maneuver, you reach to the point where you lead the people into a blind alley. So that one group said, we will agitate. We demand that you do not increase, this is simple history. We demand that you don't increase the price of rice. And the history is there. The government said we'll increase the price of rice. The other group, Moja, said, the issue of rice cannot be fundamental. What is fundamental is that you allow our people to choose their representatives. You allow our people to determine who will represent them. The government agreed, even after the rice riot. When over 70 people died, the government decided that the property clause, we said, only those who have property will vote. They removed that. They even allowed for the registration of the PAL into PPP, Progressive People's Party. The rice riot came about. If you read, and we don't have to go into this, could it have been avoided? It could have been avoided. But we are not here to argue what should have been. We are here to say what happened and why it was necessary to engage the government on that form of struggle to allow the people to then move forward with their democratic rights intact. Don't forget, the government of the day had developed what they call the Criminal Malevolent Act. If you decide to criticize people, they can hold you. The military adopted that too, decree number 88A. It was all meant to frustrate the people's will to move forward. And we were saying, okay, those on the other side, he provided water, good. He built low-cost housing, good. He gave life, good. But so did the colonial masters in colonial Africa. So did the Firestone Plantation. So did Lamco. They all provided these things. But that is not what men struggle for. Men struggle for the respect of the dignity. You are a man, I'm a man. Your children have no right to adopt a certain position and leave my children at a disadvantage. The country belongs to all of us, the resources belong to all of us. We said, no, you must now tell us, how do we transform the society so that every individual, the child of the shoemaker, the child of the rubber tapper, the child of the sweeper, has the opportunity to become a doctor, a lawyer, a professor. You must say to us, how are you going to address this? And you can only address this if you address the question of how you distribute resources in our country. So we dealt with that question. But where do we go as a people? Now, let me say to those who say, these are troublemakers. Oh, I heard a lot of things. But don't forget now, some of us could have joined the regime. As a matter of fact, we had parents in that regime. We had parents. My father had been an ambassador. But no, for me, that was immaterial. What was material was that after 127 years, your country was the laughing stock in Africa. You claim that your leader was progressive, he did certain things. Yes, he opened ties with countries. But he allowed the South African racist president to touch the sword of Blighted.
Yes.
He allowed Buster to come here. Desecrating this land that Blighted and others had called the land of pan-Africanism. So for us in Moja, the question was a pan-Africanist struggle. For our brothers and comrades in the PPP, there too was a question of dignity, but they will deal with Liberia. We will deal with Africa. And let me tell you the contradiction there. In dealing with Africa, we built an alliance, a united front, with the very government. Allow them to preach liberation. Allow them to preach freedom. And then the question will be asked, if the white people in South Africa are guilty of suppressing black people, what about you in your own country? Dr. Kwame Nkrumah said to us, domestic capitalism is a form of colonialism. So come with us. We remember Mr. Talbot took $600,000 to Gabon and handed it to the liberation movement. We said, well done. Well done. You're a good man. So the freedom fighters are going to buy things for the liberation struggle. So you see, I think some brothers want to drink. So we allow them. We allow them to build up a united front. We said to them, you know, when you talk about liberation in Africa, it is not the liberation of raising a flag. That is nothing. Anybody can raise a flag. Even if you put a flag on a donkey in the wall. That's not our interest. You cannot talk about political independence and freedom if you don't deal with the question of the economic emancipation of the masses. That was fundamental. And they play into our hands. Now, the Rice Riot gave them a respite. It helped them. Because what did the Rice Riot say, or the Rice demonstration? It said that people were angry. It said that things had not gone well. But the government of the day itself realized that. They went to Bentor, and they came out with a charter. How do we reform the political system? Brothers and sisters, all those you call progressive, and I will come to that term, all those you call progressive were demanding a change. Now, what was progressive? What was progressive? Why do you need progressive? Everybody in this room is a progressive. And I tell you why. For the simple fact, it simply means moving from one state of backwardness, lack of consciousness, to a state of enlightenment. Mm-hmm. It's progress. That's what progressive means. If in the 1970s, people could not vote, the Tory party met and said, so say one, so say all. If you are demanding the right of everybody to vote, that was progress. That was simply what it meant. So the progressive class was simply the group of people who were not activists on the street alone, but even some church leaders were identified as progressive. Because they were saying to them, this system is wrong. This system is bankrupt. This system cannot endure into the future. You don't give people education and decide to keep them quiet. So the first stage of our struggle was to get the right not only to represent ourselves, but also to allow for the exercise of the basic freedoms allowed in the Constitution. Freedom of speech, freedom of assembly that we have done today, freedom of association, freedom for the people to gather at all times and petition the government of the day for the redress of grievance. That was our responsibility. To say to you that for over 127 years, you have crafted a system of government which excluded the majority of the people. And then they said, we'll have election in 82. All the forces were preparing. The Progressive Alliance of Liberia had been transformed into the Progressive People's Party. Voja had changed into the Liberian People's Party. All these brothers were saying, well, now we have opened the political space. Please allow us to go to the polls. They say you go to the polls in 1983. Everybody was ready. We had been criticizing the economic backwardness. Yes, we knew there had been growth, but we say this is growth without development. Look at the masses of the people. So we were going to the polls in 83. 1980, there was a military coup. You out there on the other side, you blame us for the military coup. But these were the very military men you put on the streets in April of 1979. April 14, 1979 was the day I should have died, because you have given orders to your soldiers to shoot. For what? Because we demanded justice for the people. So that was the day we were supposed to die. We survived because, as they say, men of destiny have charm lives. Fast forward 1 year later. The very army you sent against us in the streets You say 40 died. Some people say 100. Some people say 70. We buried our colleagues in mass grave at the same spot. The very people you sent to kill us on April 14, 1979, they turned against you in 1980. How do you blame me for that? How do you blame him for that? So we come to the point where the military forms this government and it asks us to serve. And we're very careful. That's our tactical we were. We felt that these people have been brought into power by some accident of history. If we refuse to serve them, the very people they have overthrown will turn against us. So we have to understand how to maneuver. Yes, we work with them. And we are the first to say, whatever they committed while we were there, as long as we didn't oppose it, we stand before history to answer to whatever charges you can bring. Amanda. So you come, you put us before the TRC. You put us before the TRC. You say we should explain our role in the history of our people, which we did. For 9 hours, we addressed our people on what had happened. After 9 hours, we're going outside, a journalist puts the microphone in our face, but have you got an apology? And I say, apology for what? He said, apology for the 13 people who were executed. I said, Mr. Journalist, is there a man with conscience who does not feel the death of another man?
Yeah.
I said that Brother Patrick Horner, he has that tape. Then some newspaper that parrots the views of very backward tendency. Put the picture of the executed people and all the fumble, I have no apology. And the elements get angry, they get bitter. They don't ask me. They don't ask Fambule to explain what he said. They said Fambule is insensitive. A man who struggles for humanity, how can he be insensitive? They say Fambule has no conscience. No conscience? No conscience? Some of them say, we will not talk to him until we die. They tell Madam President. I say, Madam President, I understand. Tell these people, I've never been to any one of the homes to ask for food to eat. I have not gone to a single one of the homes to ask the daughter to go out. My wife is not here. If I want to find somebody, I will find a daughter of one of the people. You know, why do I say this? Because militants, comrades, when you talk about reconciliation, we have to come to the table with an honest approach. You say what happened, Bishop, let me say what happened. If you want to dialogue, let us dialogue how to go forward. But no, Bishop and others, it is not reconciliation you are looking for. No, you are not looking for reconciliation. You are looking for domination. The only time you are interested in reconciliation, when you know you are on top, elections are coming. So you want us to believe that you love Liberia so much. Who doesn't love his country? Who? That is why I keep on appealing to those who want to deprive Liberians of dual citizenship. Be careful. You cannot keep patriots away from the motherland. Patriotism is not written in the Constitution. It's written into the hearts of men. A man who loves his country, a man who loves his country, it lets a young man who is deeply in love with a beautiful girl. Yeah. He loves her passionately. That is what patriotism means. So don't deprive the brother. Don't say you cannot come home because you have another passport. Look at the circumstances. Are we afraid of competition?
Yes.
These are our brothers. Let them come. The 10-year property clause was put into the Constitution to deprive certain people. Comrades, don't let these comrades get frustrated. They might find their own grandma. The grandma is the boat that the Cuban revolutionaries came from Mexico.
Amanda! Amanda! Amanda!
They may just find their own grandma and come. They are Liberians. And in the bosom,
burns the love of the fatherland. I have seen brothers and sisters landing at rubber's feet. They kiss the soil. They have tears in their eyes. You cannot write that in the Constitution. It lies in the heart of men. So there we were. The military came in. A lot of stuff happened. A lot of stuff happened. No, leave the sisters, let them cook, no problem. So, as a matter of fact, the military took over. But let me tell you something. All these people you see today who are beating the chest, condemning people, you people put our country back upon them. These very elements, you want to know what they said about Mr. Talbot.
Yeah.
You want to know what these hypocrites said about Mr. Talbot. Most of the information that people got outside from Mr. Talbot's cabinet came from these people who were playing double games. They were telling us things. Some of them even said Mr. Talbot was a madman. That madness runs within the family. If you listen to the tip of the tribunal, they stood before the tribunal and said, this man was crazy. A crazy man that you serve, he's dead. And you say he was mad. Today you tell the Liberian people, they destroyed Mr. Talbot. No, we did not destroy Mr. Talbot. Mr. Talbot was destroyed by the contradictions of the society. Mr. Talbot was destroyed because he listened to you hypocrites, you political grasshoppers. You who jump from parties to parties. You who, when the election is coming, you want to deceive the people. You say you are sent by God. Is God crazy to send?
Sound!
Comrades! Comrades! Is God the God you worship? The God you worship? Our brothers call him Allah. The God you worship. Do you think he sent a madman to rule you? You say you were sent by God. The people rejected you. Go back. Go tell God we don't want you. You have come years later. Comrades, you have come years later. And what do you tell us now? What do you tell these people who are looking for unity? What do you tell the masses who are searching for a transformation? You now say to them, Basa Mayor must be present. Comrades, this country, you know, that's why you must understand politicians. They talk from both sides of the mouth. This country does not need a Basa president. This country does not need a vice president. This country does not need a coup president. Does not need a Dior Amano president. Does not need a Grover president. This country needs a Liberian, conscious, honest, and nationalistic. Oh! No. We've come a long way. You have the freedom to criticize. You have the freedom to criticize. You can go over the radio and say what you want to say. Don't change that into tribal politics. The Pele people want their own party. The Basa people want the mansion. The Gru people want to go behind Mr. X. The Pele people, the Vifo go behind Mr. This. You're breaking the country apart.
Yes.
Your children should be taught the question of unity. They are one people. They are one people. Please, I'm not a politician. I am a Liberian. And I remember there was a Vibe man at a meeting of Vibe people. And this man wanted to embarrass me before the people. He said to the people, and I will come, he said to the people, we will only speak in Vibe. He knew I didn't speak Vibe, so no problem, I sat there. My cousin leaned over to me. He said, Manja, I will interpret. I said, no, I don't want you to interpret. I said, let this man go on. I see where he's heading. But I will say something to him. What an old man sees when he sits under the tree, a young man does not see if he climbs. I said to him, go ahead. An old man there asked him, why do you want to go this route? He said, we've got to know who is from Cape Town. I said, but I'm not from Cape Town. My father is from Cape Town. My mother is from Cape Town. I said, but when you hear my name, it is Foyman Fambule. Where is that name from? It can only be from Cape Town. So you see, my friend, do not play the games of these lecture sequel fans, people who tell you we must vote on Christ. The poverty of our people cuts across all tribes. Those who have money, when they mix, they put on the black coat, the bowler hat. When they mix, they don't talk crime, tribe, they talk money. Yeah. And so when the masses meet, they must not talk tribe. They must talk how do we abolish the poverty and take control of our resources. Yes. So those who call themselves progressives decided that coming back to the country after another tyranny, a brutal and wretched tyranny, they would then form alliance. You see, brothers, when you are involved in a political struggle, only a silly man will form alliance with somebody who is stronger and who can crush him at any time. So you form an alliance with somebody who is weak and who depends on you. So while he's developing, you are developing. By the time he gets strong, you're strong. Because the only person who determines the journey, ourselves. Ourselves. It's possible the place is hot for the brothers. But don't worry, don't worry. Very soon I show you will come out of this place. But we can say something. No, we can say something. Wherever the people are, is where you go. No matter how difficult the situation, you cannot give up. I listen to brothers on the radio. They say there's poverty. I say, of course there is poverty. You say there's corruption. I say, of course there's corruption. Your value system itself is corrupt. A young man comes to me asking for scholarship. He wears a $300 suit. He wears gold on his hands. His shoes is probably $200. He comes to me. I say, young man, you have a problem. You have a problem. You want a scholarship. You are dressed like a millionaire. I say, my brother, when I was a student at Probate College, we wore our sandals and khaki because we couldn't afford it. The young man goes over the radio. He says, Dr. Fambule lives in his father's house. I say, but that's my father's house. That's not your father's house. The young man says, he says, Dr. Fambule is a useless man. He eats at his mother's house. I said, but that's my mother's house. Have I gone to your mother to ask for food? No. You should be happy. Young man, you're talking against corruption. You should be happy that I work in a position where you cannot pinpoint a single businessman I've put for money. Yeah. You cannot appoint a single voucher that I've signed. Yeah. You never hear about Fambule. Yeah. And I said to his friend, yeah. I said, let me tell you something. You are the one condemning corruption. It reminds me of a young man who told his father, I want to marry a girl who is untouched. I want to marry a virgin. The old man in his wisdom gave him an example. Say, young man, there are two women, there are two beautiful girls. One goes to the convent. She stayed for 5 years. She's untouched. The other one lives in the slum community where people use drugs, they do all kinds of things, drink. The two women come before you. Which one of them will you take as your wife?
The one living in the slum.
The sister just said it, the one who lived in the slum. Do you know why? She has been getting challenges. You don't know the woman who was in the convent if she's exposed to the same hazard of society. She wouldn't be worse. So you condemn me. You say the system is corrupt. I say yes, because of your value system. But you say I live in a little house in my father's house. I don't build a house. Do I have to build a house? You cannot define me by private property.
Yeah.
You will never, I will never allow you to say, you want to find Dr. Fambule? That big blue house there.
Yeah.
No. You missed the point. You missed the point, brother. If you're a private businessman, you get into the private sector, you can make money. You call me, I will sit around your swimming pool. I live in Europe, I know how to enjoy myself. Nice glass of wine. I go to Nigeria. But once you work in government, the resources belong to the people. And so I say to you, let's stop dwelling on corruption. You know why? Because there's no statute of limitation on the prosecution of corrupt people. Just pray that you have courageous young men at the LSCC and at GSC. I know one such young man, Wesley Naka. I seen some of the documents. These are honest brothers. So why are you bothered? When the time comes, these people will come before the judgment seat of history.
Yes.
They will answer. You just make sure you have the documents to prove. You expect. But look, many of these brothers and sisters who come from America, they come with that dream, the SUV mentality, the $10,000 suit, the gold ring or so. They believe what 50 Cent said. Get rich quick or die. But no comrades, no comrades. You can do that in the private sector. So we the first to say certain people should go before the courts. And that will be addressed. So you ask us, what is the contribution of the progressive in the development of our country? Political freedom. Where we sit, we will not allow anybody to put our militants in prison because they speak their minds. Where we sit, you can insult all you want to, you can say all you want to say. We have the right to defend you. Because they say, when the people fear the government, it's tyranny. When the government fears the people, that's democracy. It's your country. And you have to work to protect the resources. Don't get carried away, because I tell you, many of your people who condemn corruption are some of the most corrupt. Where I said, I know people who get documents revealing corruption. They call politicians. I got this, when we talk, everything will be all right. Yeah. You are dishonest yourself. But now we keep quiet. They can beat their chest because we know who they are. So comrades, what are the challenges? What are the challenges? The progressive forces have come full circle in the political arena. What they could not do, they can do. What you could not do, you know. Regardless of who you have representing you, they are your representatives. You have the right to recall them. You have a right to criticize them. That is the beginning. That is the beginning of building consciousness. That's the political struggle. Like all African countries went through the political struggle. What is the key challenge of this century for your generation? Is the emancipation of the people. And how do you do that? You see, many people here say, this government has the problem here. You have to look at where you came from. In 10 years, will more be done? I will say, yes, more could have been done. But the problem is within the confines of what you set yourself to do. You say, let's go forward. Let the opposition come with a manifesto. Let us see. As for the progressive forces, it's always been there. The question of economic emancipation. Providing for the people in the villages, in a remote area of the country. We have to get to the point where Monrovia must not be seen as the center of all our activities. We have to open up the countryside, move into the countryside. You tell me, for the sake of argument, what is the Ministry of Agriculture doing in the capital city? You have so many examples. Able-bodied men, school children. I was very happy the other day. Comrade, you were in Museveni said, we will train the students to fight against these Islamic fundamentalists. All the students with the energy, probably the time will come when they will be asked to perform he has to perform to defend the motherland. They have to do that. Comrade, those who represent the political forces, obviously today, they are fighting for political space like anybody. We cannot say they mean well, because it's said, you don't know the true character of the man until you gave him power.
Give him power.
Exactly.
Give him power.
You don't know. And politicians are very crafty people. That is why we tell our militants, please, don't try to be politicians. Try to be revolutionary soldiers of the people. That's all you want to do. Serve the people. Put your service at their disposal. Your degrees are meaningless if they are not meant to serve the people and to serve the motherland. This is what we believe. So how they can help? They can help by maintaining stability. They can help by maintaining the freedom of expression. They can help by making sure they present alternative programs if they are interested in elections. And you, as conscious people, you have the right to choose. You have the right to question. The man who is afraid of taking your questions is the man who is set to deceive you when you put him in office. So brothers and sisters, when you come to battle for the soul of a country, do not play the politics of the belly. It's your children's future which is at stake. I'm almost at the twilight of my life. I fought my struggle in the context of my time. I decided as a young man that I will not rest until I've stood firmly on the wretched body of the tyranny and the oligarchy. That was my decision. You think my parents were in concern? Oh, they were concerned. They were concerned. But I choose that. Not to join, but to fight for liberty. To fight for justice. It is our responsibility to change our country. Simply because this country belongs to everybody. No matter how backward it is our country. And we love this country like you have to love your wife. As a young woman, she's beautiful. She's growing up. The makeup and everything. But as she grows old, the teeth fall out. The hair fall out. But if you love her because of her heart, you still love her. That's how we love our country. That's what we keep coming back. We keep coming back. And no matter how long it takes, no matter how difficult the struggle, we hope that one day with the people conscious and determined, we raise the flag of victory.
Yes.
Telling them that these are just, if you like, these are just intervals. We spent years in exile, knowing that that regime then will self-destruct. You cannot come and shoot off people because you want to wear a $10,000 Pierre Cardin suit. You cannot. I know this brother. I said to him, you're going nowhere. You self-destruct. He said, I challenge you. Go before, my friend. Take the power. Take the power. It's easy to take the power. It's one thing to get the people to believe in you. Your only true security is not in the guns and these people who move around. It is in the love the masses have for you. We were coming here today. Some people say, oh, let me just see these three brothers. I say, what? I come, I don't wear bulletproof, I don't carry the gun. I will come among the people. I will explain to them. If they feel that I've not done right, it is a right to question me. If they feel I haven't been honest with them, it is their responsibility to map up where I've been dishonest. If they feel that I do not talk anymore, I say, but 9 hours I sat before the TRC, I gave you my interpretation of the history of this country. Please, young men, do not wait for me. The great Martinican philosopher, Frantz Fanon, said, every generation must offer relative obscurity, discover its mission, fulfill it or betray it. My generation mission was to make sure we could meet here today. We could elect our brothers. They could see the options of going in politics or going to the private sector. We tried to accomplish that. Did we succeed? The masters say we failed. Probably they're right. Because there were some of our brothers who called the masters onto the street. Be careful how you call the people into history. The people do not go halfway in history. When you call them, they expect you to go all the way and take the power. The fact that April 14, you didn't take the power, things happen in the country. Had we taken the power, the masses would have talked differently. So yes, we were short-sighted. The leaders we had, and we are the first to honor our leaders, they probably had their own reasons. But the masses keep saying to us, we want transformation. Can you transform the society? That's what they're asking you. That's what they say you have failed. It is no insult. Accept the criticism of the people. Because the combined wisdom of the people is by far superior to the intelligence of one man.
So,
brothers, I know you have a lot of questions. I say to those who call themselves progressives, they must come before the seat of history and tell you the plans of economic transformation. Like the political opponents, they must tell you the plan for political transformation, for social transformation. Let everybody answer. Do not live on past glories. Because you were successful in dodging the bullets of a wicked oligarchy. You beat your chest today. That's past. That's past. The people are saying, well, yes, you did that. So and so and so. So you explain to the people the context in which you operated. And say to them, not this boastful nonsense, absurdity, progressive take power in 2017. What have you done to take power in 2017? Oh, you just say it. You just say it. And we must be impressed. But no, we are not impressed. You will have to explain further. We don't want excuses. Explain to us what went wrong. If we are satisfied, we go and we will vote you so that you can continue the transformation, if that is what you believe in. These people are not going to settle for only political liberation. These people are not going to settle for only political representation. These people will demand the economic transformation of the country. And those who cannot provide for them will then come to understand the wrath of an angry people. Comrades, there's much work to be done. I thank you, and I want to take your questions anytime.